Hi friends, today I am giving a lecture on example problem on inference rules for predicate logic. Now we have to verify the validity of the given statements. Okay, whether the given statement produces the valid conclusion or not by using inference rules. That we are discussed in this video. In the previous video, we are already discussed about one example problem on inference rules for predicate logic. Please refer that video, and also we have to refer this video and future video also. We are solving 5 or 6 example problems on predicate logic, inference rules for predicate logic. Okay. Now, verify the validity of the following argument. So, they are given some statements. Okay. First of all, these are the statements. These statements can be represented in symbolic form. Okay. After that, we have to verify that whether this conclusion is valid or not. Okay. So, in this problem, every living thing is a plant or an animal. This is the first statement. John's goldfish is alive and it is not a plant. This is the second statement. All animals have hearts. This is the third statement. Therefore, John's goldfish has a heart. Okay, so this is the conclusion. These are the given three statements and this is the conclusion. We have to verify that whether these statements produces or derives this conclusion or not. If they derive this conclusion, we can say that it is a valid argument or valid conclusion. Otherwise, it is not a valid conclusion or an argument. Okay. So, first of all, let us consider X is a living thing. X is nothing but every living thing. Every living thing. Okay. Next one. So, here X is a plant. X is a plant. This is a one statement. In this one, is a plant is nothing but predicate. X is nothing but subject. So, is a plant, that is a predicate, that predicate can be denoted by P. Next, here in this statement, subject is X. So, that X can be written within the parenthesis. So, this is called as proposition function at X. Okay. Next one, X is an animal. So, X is an animal. Animal. Okay. Is an animal is the predicate and X is the subject. So, is an animal is the predicate. That predicate can be denoted by capital A. And the subject here is X. That X can be write within the parenthesis. Okay. Next one. John's goldfish. John's goldfish is denoted by John's goldfish. So, this is a noun. Simply we can write it as John's goldfish J. John's goldfish is represented by J. Okay. Next one. All animals have hearts. That means X has heart. X has heart. Okay. Here has heart is nothing but predicate and X is the subject. So, has heart predicate can be denoted by capital X and the subject is X that can be denoted by H of X. Okay. Here the subject X can be written within the parenthesis. Predicate can be written outside the parenthesis. Okay. Remaining. So, three statements we are getting. Once we are writing the predicate functions. Okay. Next, we have to represent the above symbols by using these predicate functions. Okay, represent the given statements, represent the given statements in symbolic form, in symbolic form. Symbolic form. Okay. First one is, every living thing is a plant or animal. Every living thing. Every living thing is a plant or an animal. Okay. So now we have to represent this given statement by using these predicate functions. Every living thing is nothing but X. So X is a plant. X is a plant is nothing but P of X. Okay. ORR, that is nothing but connective R. An animal. X is an animal, can be denoted by A of X. Okay. So, every living thing is a plant or animal. So, that is nothing but P of X or A of X. Okay. Next one. So, every living thing, every is nothing but for all. For all. Okay. Every living thing is nothing but, every is nothing but universal quantifier. Okay. For all X, P of X or A of X. Next one, second statement. John's goldfish is alive. So, John's goldfish is alive is nothing but every living thing. So, that means John's goldfish is alive is nothing but John's goldfish is a living animal. That means, and it is not a plant. So, this entire statement is nothing but John's goldfish is not a plant. That is the meaning. Okay. So, John's goldfish is not a plant. Is not a plant. Okay. So, John's goldfish is alive is nothing but, so John's goldfish is a living animal, but it is not a plant. That is the meaning. After combining these two, we are getting John's goldfish is not a plant. Okay. Is a plant is nothing but P of X. Okay. Is not a plant is nothing but negation P of X. Okay. Negation P of X. Okay. That is equivalent to negation P of X. Here X is nothing but every living thing. But here that every living thing has a particular name, that is a John's goldfish. So that can be written as negation P of G. Okay. Because X is a every living thing. That every living thing name is John's goldfish. So that we have to write negation P of G. Okay. So, is X is a plant is nothing but P of X. X is not a plant is nothing but negation P of X. Where the subject X has a particular name, that is John's goldfish. So, John's goldfish can be written as J, sorry. So, it can be written as negation P of J. Okay. Next, third one, all animals have hearts, all animals have hearts, all animals have hearts. Okay, that means for all x, if x is an animal, then x has a heart. X has a heart. X has a heart. Okay. So, this statement is logically equivalent to this statement. Okay. Now, this can be written as for all X is nothing but for all X. If X is an animal, X is an animal is nothing but it can be written as A of X. Next, X has a heart. X has a heart is nothing but H of X. In between them, so we have to write the connective if then connective. So that if then connective we are using. Okay. Next one, conclusion. Conclusion is John's goldfish has a heart. So John's goldfish has a heart. Okay. Here, has a heart is nothing but H of X we have to return. Okay. H of X. Okay. So that implies here in the place of X we have to substitute John's goldfish, because here X is the subject, but that subject has a particular name, that is a John's goldfish. So it can be written as H of J. Okay. So now this is the conclusion. Okay. So therefore the premises are, what are the premises we are getting here? For all x, P of X or A of X. Second premise is negation, P of J. Third premise is for all X, A of X, conditional, H of X. From that one, the conclusion is H of J. This is the conclusion. From that three given premises, we have to derive, this is the conclusion. Okay. So now, first I am taking the premise. That premise is this one. I am taking this premise. This premise is introduced into the derivation. Okay. So first step, I am taking first premise. First step in the derivation, that is for all X. So P of X or A of X. This premise is introduced into the derivation by using rule P. Okay. So now, first of all, we have to eliminate the universal quantifier, because any implication rule can be applied. Okay. So first of all, we have to eliminate the quantifier. Okay. After eliminating the quantifier, then we have to apply the implication rule or equivalence rule. Okay. So that for removing the universal quantifier, which rule we have to apply? That is the rule US, universal specification. So by using the rule US, we have to eliminate the quantifier. Okay. And change the variable name. Here the variable name is in the remaining premises, J is there. So we have to change the variable name as J after eliminating the universal quantifier using rule US on the step 1. Okay, this is the step 1. So for the same step, next step in the derivation, we are eliminating the universal quantifier and change the variable name P of J or A of J. Why we are changing the name as J? Because in the remaining premises J is there. Because of that reason, we have to change the variable name or subject name as J. Okay. So next one. Next, I am taking this premise is introduced into the derivation by using rule P. After second step, this is the third step, and the third step in the derivation, negation P of J. Okay. By using rule P, this premise is introduced into the derivation. Now we have to check that here J is there, here J is there, here J is there. There is no quantifiers are there. Now again we are applying the Eytan rule on these two steps, 2 and 3. Okay. So after for applying the Eytan implication rule, we have to combine these two steps, that is 1, 3. After combining these two steps, we are getting 1, 3. Next step in the derivation, fourth step. So here rule T applied on which steps? Second step and third step, 2, 3 and Eytan. So what is Eytan? Eytan rule is negation P, PRQ implies Q. Okay, negation P, PRQ implies Q. Here in the place of negation P, negation P of J is there. P place P of J is there. In the place of Q, E of J is there. Okay, that implies Q. Q means here P, negation P, PRQ. So then we are getting Q. In the place of Q, A of J is there. This is a negation P. This is a P, this is a Q. Negation P, P, R, Q. We are getting Q in the place of Q, that is A of J is there. Okay. So, by using the implication rule Eytan performed on the second step and the third step by using rule T, we are getting A of J. Okay. Now, this premise is introduced into the derivation by using rule P. So, after fourth step, now we go for fifth step. So, fifth step in the derivation is, so for all x, A of x conditional h of x. Okay. So, by using rule P, this premise is introduced into the derivation. So, now here A of j is there. So, here suppose here A of j is there. Here h of j is there, a of j conditional h of j, then we are getting h of j. Because of that reason, we have to eliminate the universal quantifier in this step and change the variable name as j. Okay, so now after we have to perform the rule us on the same step. This is next step in the derivation. We are getting A of J conditional H of J. So by using rule US applied on which step? That is the fifth step. Rule US is used for eliminating the universal quantifier from the given premise and change the variable name. Okay. Now by combining this step and this step, that is 1, 3 and 5. So then we are getting H of J. So 1, 3 and 5, we have to combine them. 1, 3, 5. This is seventh step in the derivation. So by using rule T applied on which step? Fourth step and seventh step. Fourth step and seventh step. And which rule I am using? I11. What is I11? I11 is P, P conditional Q implies Q. P, P conditional Q implies Q. So once again I am writing. And I11. So that is P, P conditional Q implies Q. Okay. So here this is a P and this is P, this is Q. P, P conditional Q implies Q. We are getting H of J. Okay. So now we are getting H of J. Here H of J is the conclusion. We are already getting H of J. So therefore, it is a valid argument. It is a valid argument. Because we have to derive the conclusion H of J from the given premises. Three premises. Okay. We are getting H of J. So therefore, the given statements are valid arguments. Because from the three premises, we have to derive this conclusion. So, it is a valid, hence we can say that it is a valid argument. In this way, we have to solve the given problem by using inference rules. So thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, please share this video to your friends and classmates. If you like this video, please subscribe my channel name. So the Bella Srinivas Rao.